What is that?
That's the Jose. That sounds like knocking on the door. Good evening and welcome to tonight's meeting of the Commonwealth Club, held in association with the club's Inforum, where you connect your intellect. You can find the club online at commonwealthclub.org and follow Inforum on Twitter or via the hashtag InforumSF. I'm Phil Bronstein, editor-at-large at Hearst Newspapers. I'm your moderator for this evening. I'm also, one could argue, collateral damage in this story. But we'll talk about that a little bit, because Jose is a friend and a former employer. Tonight's guest has been a highly successful journalist with a big secret, which may still be a secret to you if you've been locked in the food locker at the International Space Station. You probably haven't heard about it. Jose Antonio Vargas was part of the Washington Post coverage of the Virginia Tech shootings in 2007. That coverage won a Pulitzer. He's gone on to report for the Huffington Post and a variety of prestigious publications, and he snagged a fabulous interview with Facebook founder Mark Zuckerberg for The New Yorker. So everything was going well. And then 3 weeks ago or so, he came out as an illegal immigrant, which created a shower of publicity, of interviews, rage on the part of conservatives, sympathy on the part of many liberals and progressives, though in newsrooms around the country, the feelings were quite complicated. Among journalists and editors who hired him, including me, where he did not, let's say, fully disclose the circumstances of his circumstance when he was hired. He has become a full-blown advocate for the passage of the DREAM Act since he came out, which would make allowances for kids who came here as minors to be permanent residents. He's also started an organization called Define America. Is it .org?
DefineAmerican.com.
His credibility, objectivity, personal promotion, and character have all been called into question. And I warned him early about this, that this would happen. He was sent here at age 12 in 1993, found out his green card had been faked when he, on a Xerox machine when he was 16, decided he would earn his citizenship not with candor necessarily, but certainly with hard work. Started his journalism career in Mountain View as an intern. He brought friends and some school officials and other mentors into his web of secrets. Some of them are here tonight, and he can introduce them. He worked at the Chronicle and the Philadelphia Daily News, but was rejected by the Seattle Times because they demanded more documentation, which he did not have. And he got an Oregon driver's license to get an internship at the Washington Post. He needed that kind of documentation. I hired Jose a while ago as a reporter because I thought he was an extraordinarily talented young man. I didn't ask him any questions about his immigration status, and I pushed him for a job 6 months ago with the Hearst Corporation in New York.
Yes.
Because I didn't know then, and nor could I figure out why he never followed up on the job interview. I wrote a column or a blog post on SF Gate that started with the sentence, "I was duped." And a lot of people took that seriously. Before, you know, Jose lived with a secret, which has been labeled a lie by people, including me, and now he has the, I think he thinks, maybe dubious distinction of being a celebrity by virtue of his confessional revelations. So first of all, are there any immigration agents in the building?
That's really funny.
Is that a no?
I'll be at the Starbucks on the corner of O'Farrell. I'm kidding. Just kidding.
Jose, I have not seen too many neutral people on the issue of you as the sort of poster person for immigration.
Yeah.
It seems that there's no one who is neutral on immigration, and I suspect that you've found that out in a somewhat painful way. Even just the language, illegal immigrants, illegal aliens, it depends on, it's sort of like pro-life, pro-choice. Even the language is charged. So how's it been since you wrote your article for the New York Times?
You know, it's only, I think today's the 18th day. it feels like an eternity. I should say, by the way, thank you for being here, for taking the time. We really appreciate it. And thanks to Phil. Actually, when I disclosed my status to you, I said that I wanted to do this. I wanted to do a public Q&A, and I wanted to do it where I came from, which is Mountain View, which is the Bay Area. So I'm glad that we were able to pull this off. But to your question, how it's been, you know, I basically treated this like it was the biggest news story I was ever going to tell, and researched it as such. I've been a journalist for 13 years. It's all I've actually known. And some parts of me expected how the media was going to react. That's one thing. But the best part actually has been hearing from people on Twitter or on Facebook or emailing us, basically saying, you know, I had never thought about immigration this way before. Because, you know, in this country, back to your point, we talk a lot about immigration. We do. But we don't really talk a lot about immigrants.
Well, we talk about immigrants, but we often talk about a certain kind of immigrant.
Yes.
And you and I had this conversation. And now, when Jose came out to me, basically, we made an appointment to have coffee out at the Presidio, and he showed up with his cameraman.
Yes.
Because he's doing...
I'm doing a documentary.
So I don't know what my reaction was, but I'm going to find out right, when I look at this thing. But, you know, one of the conversations we had at that point, or right thereafter, was how much do day laborers, who have the public, often the public face of immigration, how much are they going to relate to you? You have talked about how you can relate to them.
Yes.
Question is, how can they relate to you? You're privileged, but from most people's perspective, you've had a...
I've worked hard for that. It wasn't as if...
Well, but I think those people also work hard.
Of course, yes. But, I mean, it's been fascinating, again, hearing from, I guess, the shock from the media world and the shock from the newsroom world has been, how dare this undocumented immigrant get in this newsroom and not tell us, right? That's been part of the shock. The other part has been, oh, we thought we knew what undocumented immigrants were. We had this profile of what they were supposed to look like or sound like or be like. And I guess this is what happens when you... Which is why when I decided to do this, I said to myself, you know, like, am I personally ready for whatever this is going to be? That was the first question. The second question was, what purpose does the story serve? Which as a journalist is always really the question, right? When you tell a story, what purpose does it serve? What truth does it illuminate? And that's why I decided to do it. Because by the way, in this room right now, I'm not going to point them out because some of them are not out yet, so to speak. Within this room are some undocumented students that are working really hard so that you know that they're just like you. You wouldn't know by looking who they are, but they're here. And in many ways, back to your question, undocumented immigrants definitely are also the day laborers and the babysitters and the people that make sure that we eat lettuce for that amount so that the burger stays that price, right? That. But more than just that, this problem of the fact that we have been playing political football with immigration has led to the problem being this bad and being this mature. I mean, in many ways, I've always said this, that the only thing I represent is just how incredibly dysfunctional this whole system is. And a lot of other students and a lot of other people, 11 million of us, can tell you that much, from the day laborer to the kid at Stanford Law School who's trying to figure out how he's going to get a job after law school, to this guy who happened to, I was lucky enough to have been mentored by some people in this room to be whoever I am. We come in all shapes and sizes, and we speak all different languages, and we are not who you think we are. That was the point.
Did you make it?
Did I make it?
Do you think you successfully made it?
That's a good question.
That's what I'm here for.
I remember I had five interviews with Mark Zuckerberg, and the last one was, I said, you know, Mark, dude, we need to, like, I wanted not his PR guy, I just wanted for us to take an hour-long walk. So we walk, like, you know, he lived at the time seven blocks from his work. So we took a long walk, like an hour-long walk. And I was thinking to myself, I'm interviewing Mark Zuckerberg. Okay. I swear to God, I wanted to tell him. I was like, hey. FYI, because, you know, the
it's
title,
Facebook, why not?
The title was, the article was Mark Zuckerberg opens up. And I'm like, dude, Jose. And back to your success question. So that article ran, and you know, when I was growing up, the New Yorker was like my Bible. I didn't major in journalism, actually. Everything I ever learned about writing, I learned from reading. So the New Yorker was my Bible. And writing for that magazine, the moment of waking up in New York where I live, and going to the newsstand and seeing my name on that thing, it wasn't even, they could have not have paid me. I would have done it anyway. And then knowing full well that I'm supposed to be successful or privileged, right? Because I've gotten to this point. And knowing that whatever that success is still tied to the fact that I'm undocumented and I'm living a lie. And the fact that I've tried to honestly live with whatever lie this is. No, to me, success is being able to go to bed at night peacefully. And I've never been able to do that. So no, I don't consider myself successful.
What I meant by success, that was a great answer.
Well, thank you.
But what I meant by success was, do you feel you successfully made the point as powerfully as you intended to make it? Because, you know, we had the Casey Anthony story, and I can't even remember how many stories in this last couple of weeks that have consumed the oxygen of news and cable and all of our attention. And Jose Antonio Vargas, you know, I checked today before I came here on Google, and you know, it's been a few days, and in some cases a few weeks, since there have been stories. So this huge upsurge of publicity, and then like every other great big story,
it dies down. Well, I actually am glad about that, because now I think actually we can get to work. now that they're getting over the fact that this undocumented immigrant who happened to have won a part of a Pulitzer and have done all these things happens to be an undocumented immigrant. And again, I decided to do this because we had to create, there had to be in many ways a tipping point in terms of what, last year was a great year for activism among like young undocumented students, right? That to me was the tipping point. I had nothing to do with that. All I was doing was sitting at home in my apartment in New York, feeling very comfortable and feeling very like obligated to say something. And for me to say something, I knew that I couldn't just say something. I had to say something, then I had to do something, which is what DefineAmerican.com is about. And now that they're dying down to interest on this Jose person, we can actually get to work.
You can't work.
Well, yes, I can't legally work. By work, there was a great article that I hope people here have read by the Associated Press 3 days ago, and it actually featured like the heroes in my life, which I'm sorry that I'm gonna point them out right now, and I'm gonna make them stand up if you don't mind, Phil. So Pat Hyland, if you can stand up for a second. This is my high school principal. And Rich Fisher, my high school superintendent, who's like my dad, is all the way back there. So this great AP story that ran in like 250 newspapers or something, including like the South Dakota paper, actually featured them, and it started talking about, the piece was not about me, it was like one sentence on me, and more about what position the government and the lack of action in this issue have put educators in. All of us go through teachers. We can go across this country right now, every part of this country, and you talk to a teacher, as I've been hearing from emails from educators who were like, I just had a kid who told me that this is why he wasn't applying to college. I finally found out it's because he's undocumented and he can't apply for financial aid. I don't know what to tell the kid. I don't know what to tell the kid. As far as I'm concerned, that part of the story is really how, you know, 3 years ago, as I was telling Phil, I was in Iowa and New Hampshire covering the presidential campaign, right? And if we actually talk to those people who never really think about immigration in this way and start talking about teachers and start talking about what are we supposed to do with these kids, I think that's when we reframe and kind of elevate the conversation out of the heated Republican versus Democrat, they're illegal aliens who are mooching off the system, never mind that I've been paying taxes since the day I've been working. You know, to me, we get out of that box by telling different stories. And really, back to your point too, Phil, like the press has a lot of responsibility here. And in some ways they've failed. I mean, it's interesting how the media criticism of this has actually exposed that. Because instead of talking about why did somebody like Jose Vargas had to lie, the question had been, he lied, which is fine, which is great. But I'm hoping that in the next few weeks, we can actually get to a point where, why are people forced to lie? Or why do people make these choices? Oh, the system is broken. That's why. So the connecting of the dots and making sure that we're looking at the systems, I think, is very important.
Well, in my own defense.
Oh, no, please.
This is what I refer to as the atrociously rudderless but vicious debate on immigration reform.
Great line.
So, you know, I don't think that that's actually entirely accurate, that the press, in their great stampede to call you a liar, ignored the larger issue. But let me ask you something that you asked sort of about teachers and educators. What would you tell that kid who had a chance at an internship with a fake ID at the Washington Post or the Chronicle or anywhere else and came to you for advice?
You know, they're coming now, and I don't know what to tell them.
You can tell them something?
I have, and basically the extent of it is you got to do what you got to do. In Tagalog, we have a saying called kapit sa patalim, which basically means just holding on to the knife. And that's kind of basically what I've been doing. But I am not about to tell people to check boxes that they're not supposed to check and go to a state to get a driver's license. I made that choice. And I'm sorry for making that choice. I don't know what to tell them. And actually, I came to the Bay Area in February and I met with a group called Educators for Fair Consideration, E4FC. And it was really the first time that I got to meet with a lot of undocumented students. And at that point, I was only telling them that I was doing a documentary on immigration, which I am. And of course, I didn't divulge my own status to it. It was really hard to look them in the eye. Just because I was in their spot just like 7 years ago.
You said you were sorry.
Yeah.
What is it you're sorry for exactly?
I'm sorry that we're in this situation. I'm sorry that a kid at Crittenden Middle School or Graham Middle School where I come from is sitting there, he's probably 12 or she's 12, and she's hearing all these people refer to her as illegal. I'm sorry that there are teachers out there who have to make these choices in terms of what my principal or my superintendent had to do, because all they wanted to do was, there's the legal calling, then there's a moral calling, and they responded to the moral calling. I'm sorry that I had to lie to the newsrooms. The Washington Post, like the Chronicle, was like my journalism school. And the Washington Post was my home. I literally slept there because I was working on a story. So I'm sorry that I had to lie. But then again, the question becomes, why did I have to do that? And it's just one person. I can only imagine how many doctors or lawyers or engineers, and forget the doctors, because not everybody's a doctor and engineer. Everybody just wants to survive. They want to be able to have food on the table and a roof up top of their head, right? I'm sorry that we have to make these choices. But what are we supposed to do? Would you have rather that, again, if I had divulged at the Chronicle that I was undocumented, then I couldn't have worked there. If I divulged to the Washington Post that I was undocumented, I wrote maybe 300 or something news stories for the Washington Post. I don't know what would have happened.
You've been knocked around a little bit by people who say, hey, look, the situation is atrocious. We're not going to make any judgment one way or the other about what you did or didn't do.
Yeah.
But there are all these other people out there who are lining up within the system.
Exactly, yeah.
The system that you felt so strongly about being a part of.
Yeah.
There is a system, however horribly flawed it is, for people to try and get residency status, to
exactly,
try and get citizenship. And there are just, I don't know how many.
Lines of people
thousands
waiting.
Thousands and tens of thousands,
yes,
and maybe hundreds of thousands of people, and they're pointing at you and going, wait a minute.
Exactly.
Get in line with us.
I would love to get in the back of some line. If anybody has a line, please tell me where to go. If you want me to pay a fine, I'd be more than happy to pay a fine. I mean, this is the whole point. Like, tell me where the line is. I'll get there like tomorrow, like right now. But this is the problem. There isn't a line. There isn't a solution. All we have is angry rhetoric, a lot of which is based on uninformed, overheated debate. The fact, for example, that last year, undocumented immigrants paid $11.2 billion in local and state taxes. Why didn't you ever hear about that? Because we don't. So And yes, I would be more than happy. I've heard from some Filipinos, actually, Filipino-Americans here or Filipinos in the Philippines who have said, this is embarrassing. Why didn't you get in the back of the line? And of course, I tell them that, you know, I've responded to a couple of emails and I've said, you know, I got here when I was 12 and I didn't know, you know, that I was undocumented, right? But then again, by the time I was in your newsroom, I was an adult who made a choice. So I've said that I'm sorry, which is, of course, is never enough. And then I've said, please, you know, if there's a back of a line, let me know, and I'll get back. I'll pay a fine.
Could you at any point have tried to get one of your employers to sponsor you?
Actually, at one point, well, no, because what happened was, actually, the Rich Fisher, who's here, and actually, I hate to embarrass him, but a man who's here who basically had set up the foundation that gave me the scholarship to get to to get to San Francisco State. I had actually never disclosed to him what my status was, but the scholarship didn't care about what my status was. And when I finally told him what it was, because I didn't get the Seattle Times internship, he actually said, why don't you go meet with an immigration lawyer and I'll pay for it. So Rich Fisher and I went to a lawyer here in Financial District. This was 2002, and I remember this, it was like yesterday. And this was right after 9/11, and the lawyer said, you had already checked a box that you weren't supposed to check, right? No. Being at the Chronicle. And she basically said, you can go home. The only solution is for you to go back to the Philippines, accept a 10-year bar, and then try to come back. And I swear to God, as we walked out of that office, I was thinking, okay, maybe that is the option. But Rich Fisher looked at me and said, you're not going to do that. This man said to me that I wasn't going to do that, that I was going to compartmentalize this problem, and I was going to keep going. And then that summer, he took me to Hawaii with his family for a vacation because he knew I was so distraught. So if he had told me that what I needed to do was go back to the Philippines for 10 years, that's probably what I would have done. If Peter Pearl at the Washington Post, after I disclosed my status to him, had told me, we have to report you to INS or ICE right now, that's probably what we would have done. Which is why, this is the larger point, is that illegal immigration is not just about undocumented people. Illegal immigration is about all of us, because all of us play a role in it. We all do, we all know that. So now the question becomes, what is going to be the role of the documented American citizens in getting some sort of traction and in coming to some sort of resolution in this issue?
Well, you know, even undocumented is a misnomer because people who are illegally have tons of documents.
They're just, yes, it's just that they're not the right kind of documents.
So
good point, Phil. Good point.
You mentioned Peter Pearl.
Yeah, he's a great guy.
Who was, I guess, a training editor at the Washington Post when you were there, and you disclosed to him. And I talked to him after you came out.
Oh, you did?
I did.
I didn't know that.
And I know that he gave you permission to out him in your
oh,
story.
Oh, yeah.
Five
times.
Okay. But you had a choice, ultimately, whether to out him or not. That was, as the writer of the piece, that was your choice. And I don't know what's happened since, but at that time, the Washington Post had issued a statement saying what he did was wrong, which he felt, I think appropriately, was a rather ominous sign for his... future employment. Why did you?
Actually, no. What ended up happening was, you know, I wasn't in Washington, D.C. when this was getting edited. He actually came to the editor of the piece and said, Jose has talked to me about this piece, and I'm glad to be included. And even my principal, my superintendent, my choir teacher, Jim Strand, who started the scholarship fund, every name in that piece, I had to clear it to all of them because I wasn't about to drag anybody in my mess.
But the question is not,
but
did
Peter,
you get permission?
No, not only did I get permission, Peter, actually talked to the editor of the piece and said that I want to be included. I'm not sure if he told you that.
No.
Yeah,
In fact, he did that. We didn't officially speak, but...
Oh, okay. Yeah, but that's actually what happened. And because I was really afraid of him because I was most afraid for him. Because Pat and Rich... their line of reasoning has been, we're educators. We're supposed to educate this kid. With Peter, I felt like I was really letting him hang out to dry, and I didn't want to do that to him, especially considering, you know, the humanity and just the graciousness.
So how did you make that choice? I ran it by him.
I ran it by him.
No. How did you make the choice about who to tell
when
you told them? I'm not talking about a few weeks ago. I'm talking about a few years ago. Because
I know you
didn't come into my office and tell me.
Because I wasn't about to tell you.
But maybe I'm asking for trouble here. So why would you tell Peter Pearl and not other people?
Well, at that point, the only people that knew were my Mountain View High School family. And to this day, my greatest achievement is graduating from Mountain View High School. So they were the only ones that knew. And then it was one thing to be at the Chronicle in the Bay Area, an hour away from Mountain View, surrounded by them and my family, you know, my Filipino family. It was a whole other thing to be in Washington, D.C., working for the Washington Post, and hearing about immigration left and right, and knowing at any moment, you know, the Washington Post newsroom, as in any newsroom, is a cutthroat place. And I've always kind of knew that maybe somebody was going to find out. And I got so paranoid. And, you know, I actually haven't told anybody this, which I'm telling you now. It wasn't in the story. But before I told Peter Pearl, I was actually researching how to get to Canada. I was researching. There's a Globe and Mail newspaper, which I always liked. And I thought, what if I called the Globe and Mail and said, I'm undocumented? Because, you know, I had found out that Canada has friendlier immigration laws, and maybe I should just go there and then quit the Washington Post. And when I didn't go by that decision, I messaged Peter Pearl, can we go out for coffee? And I sat him in, you know, Lafayette Park across from the White House, and I just told him. And again, to your point, if he would have said to me, let's go in right now and report you, that's what would have happened. I completely recognize the fact that I'm in no position of power. Once you tell somebody, they're gonna do what they're gonna do. And it's to his great credit. And I don't know why, I mean, even to this day, man, I mean, this man and I, there aren't even words to tell you how grateful I am to him. Because again, I put his job on the line. And he says that in an interview, actually, that he recently gave, that he had just made a choice, that he knew, that he said in this interview, that if he had reported me, I would have lost my job. And that he was more willing to risk himself than to risk me.
So what have the consequences been for him?
Nothing right now. He wouldn't say specifically to the reporter exactly what the Washington Post had done to him. But clearly he hadn't gotten fired, or he hadn't. You know, Peter Pearl was hired by Ben Bradley in 1981, the year I was born. He had been in that newsroom for that long. And so I was just, thankfully, nothing has happened to him yet. And I got him, thankfully, a lot of lawyers have contacted me to offer pro bono help, which is really great. And so I made sure that he has a lawyer to talk to just in case anything happened. Because, you know, again, like, here I am dragging him to my mess, even though he wanted to be dragged into it. I just want him to be as protected as possible.
You know, journalists in particular, and newsrooms in particular, got pretty exercised.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And Marcus Broccoli, who's the current editor of the Washington Post, basically did say, I think he did say he was duped. He just uses it as an exaggeration the way I did. Phil Bennett, former editor, managing editor of the Washington Post, said that what you did was wrong, but he thought you were a hero. I mean, what was your response when you saw quotes from people like Marcus Broccoli saying you were a liar? And you deceived them, and it was inappropriate, and it was particularly inappropriate to do in a business where credibility is supposed to be and truth telling is supposed to be highly valued.
Again, I had to lie, so I'm in no position to question them, their frustration or their anger. So all I can do, is say that I am so sorry that I lied to you. But if I hadn't lied to you, I wouldn't even have been in that newsroom. I mean, which is not to excuse. Again, sorry is never enough. But I also understand Dick Rogers, who's a really great guy. I knew him when I was at the Chronicle. When I was just a guy delivering people's faxes. He was very nice to me. And he had written this piece for the Chronicle basically saying that, you know, I lied and I should have told them, and that he had an interesting statement about how I could not have worked for a traditional news organization, that maybe I could have worked for the Bay Guardian or the SF Weekly, which is a really interesting statement. really interesting statement. And the whole time, I'm thinking, you know, in many ways, I think I probably overcompensated. Like, I knew that if I ever got caught in any some sort of Jason Blair-like, Stephen Glass-like plagiarism or whatever, that they were not only were going to nail me, they were going to deport me. So I am vigilant in my journalism. I've written like 650 articles. I've had maybe 7 or 8 corrections, many of them like spelling related. I mean, which is, I'm so sorry that I misspelled people's names. But at the end of the day, the work speaks for itself. I've said that from the very beginning. It's not enough for people. They can go through the work. And here's to the point, by the way, about the bias, which I'm sure you're getting ready to ask me. Everyone has a bias. Everyone, whether we like it or not, who we are shaped the way we think. I mean, I remember being at the Chronicle when gay marriage had happened, you know, and Gavin Newsom was heroic enough to actually allow same-sex couples to marry in City Hall. And I think, was it Rachel Gordon who was...
Downhill from there for Gavin.
Yeah.
No, what happened at the Chronicle was we had a photographer and a reporter who were covering gay marriage right when it happened, and they got married.
Yeah.
And we decided that they were too much, not that they had a bias that we couldn't overcome, but that they were directly involved in the story and therefore shouldn't be covering it. And because we're not only concerned about actual conflicts, but also the appearance of conflict.
Yeah.
Because we have enough credit, we have enough credibility problems.
The news business has enough credibility problems, yeah.
So that became a huge debate.
I remember that debate.
We walked around all parts of the newsroom with Rachel and Liz, who disagreed with us, and had open discussions and debate.
Yeah.
The National Gay and Lesbian Journalists Association itself, was divided. Its members were divided on whether we did or not we did the right thing. So the issue isn't, you know, you're not allowed to have a view of immigration.
Mm-hmm.
Because that would be absurd. The issue is that you are now part of the story.
Yeah.
And you are creating an organization, have created an organization that is an advocacy organization. But so there's a question about would I assign you today to cover an immigration story? I probably wouldn't.
Yeah.
Because you're in the middle of the story, not because you have an opinion about it. Now, then, I mean, I think there were some credibility issues at the time that you came out that Schaefer and others, people, the Washington Post raised, Paul Fari, that, you know, you didn't tell the Post, and this may or may not be one of the reasons they didn't print your piece, that you had gotten another driver's license, because when you and I spoke, you didn't tell me either. What you said was this deadline was looming where your Oregon driver's license, and that was what made you decide. And the fact that you had a driver's license, an extension of a driver's license or another driver's license from Washington was I think, a reasonable fact of this story. And yet you didn't tell anybody when you, I mean, this was supposed to be a sort of hang it all out there.
Oh, and I did like let it all hang there. But 2 points I want to make. Let me go back to the gay marriage one because I think it's a really important point. Gay people aren't the only ones. Straight people have their bias around same-sex marriage. So I would actually ask that it's not just for the gay people who happen to be part of the story, it's also for the straight editors who are editing the story.
Well, if you're an editor and you go out and you protest against gay marriage,
exactly.
I would certainly not have you edit stories about gay marriage.
But what I'm
That's
saying,
participating
okay,
in the
yes.
story.
Yes, but what I'm saying to that point is, which is, again, it's so interesting, and I don't want to bore the audience about like the in and out of like inside baseball journalism, but this question of objectivity, which doesn't exist, is coming head to head with the reality that we are now living in a minority-majority country. We will soon be living in a minority-majority country, in which minorities, who in many ways are like less of a part of newsrooms, most newsrooms in this country are still run by the same people who have been running them for all these years, right? Minorities are still not well represented in newsrooms. So there's that point. To your point about the driver's license piece, when I came to the Post...
Wait.
Yeah.
So how does the appalling lack of minority representation in newsrooms address this issue of whether someone should be assigned a story when they are part of the story?
Well, at the end of the day, Rachel and Liz, they're just like any other gay couple out there who wanted to have equal rights. Whether or not they're a part of your newsroom, in my opinion, that's none of your business. That's their business as citizens of this country wanting to have that right. And
absolutely, I don't want
again,
to have the right,
which is the point is,
but they participated in the news story.
But the fact that you would then assume that they couldn't fully, in the same way that people could assume that just because I'm undocumented would mean that I would not want to tell the fuller story and wouldn't want to talk to people who don't agree with me, is, in my opinion, a rather unfair assumption. In many ways, I think I am actually even more cognizant of the fact that because I believe what I believe, I then have to go to places that don't believe what I don't believe to make sure that I actually look them in the eye and ask them, why do you actually think that I am an illegal alien who's not worthy of being here? Actually look you in the eye and have an actual civil conversation about why they believe what they believe. So that's one point. Back to the driver's license thing, because I think this is really important. When I came to the Washington Post with that story, as you can imagine, we went through like several drafts. And the first draft, it ended on my 30th birthday. That's when the driver's license expired. And I should actually say, by the way, on my 30th birthday, all of my families, my Mountain View High School family, my Filipino family, my friends, I all flew them, you know, all flew to San Francisco, and I called it like Jose might get deported 30th birthday party. And it was right into this Indian restaurant right behind us. So let me just say that. When I came to the Post with the story, I had written it as such. And then, of course, when the editor, Carlos Osada, who's a great editor, kept asking all these questions about how are you driving now? And I'm like, well, you know, I actually went to Washington State to get a new driver's license because I had to be able to fly. He's like, oh, we should include that. I'm like, of course, yeah, okay, go ahead. So we did. So which is why it's really interesting that the Washington Post, in its own, which I love, a newspaper that I love and I owe a lot to, in its own spinning of trying to explain to people why they killed the story, have now latched onto this thing, which I understand, but at the end of the day, the story was ready and fully reported and fully fact-checked to run. And the driver's license was included, like maybe a third into it. And I had, it came to the point that I actually brought all my documents there and, you know, all of that. But at the end of the day, they made the choices they made. And I'm not about to, like, the story is the story. And, you know, as we in this age of Google, I've been kind of waiting for people to just kind of pick it apart. You know, if there's any untruths, please tell me now.
Well, I mean, I think what did come up was the fact that you covered
immigration. Yeah.
Immigration.
Yeah.
You and I may have had a misunderstanding about, because I
maybe
thought that when you wrote a story about the Mission District, about people trying to get fake drivers.
Yeah, that was
license,
really, yes, that was definitely a misunderstanding. I said to you that that was the most conflicted I got.
I thought you said that you then decided you were not going to do
no,
that anymore.
Because what ended up happening was there was a couple of rallies, because I was a part of the diversity pod at the Chronicle. There was actually a good diversity pod. And there was a rally that I had to cover. So when Patty Poblete, who was the editor at the time, assigned me to cover it, what was I supposed to tell her? Like, I'm undocumented and I can't cover this rally? So I went ahead and covered it. I was so scared when I was at the Washington Post that they were going to keep assigning me these immigration stories because my name is Jose. I was terrified.
All right.
Terrified.
Since we got to the driver's license,
yeah.
Here's a question from the audience. How the heck are you traveling around these days?
Yes.
Because you came
with
from
a lot
York
of
to
luck.
Here. I thought when you left here a few weeks ago that would be the last flight you'd take.
I wore a baseball cap for the first time. I know, I've worn baseball caps before, but the Philippine embassy in the New York is kind enough to actually let me get a Filipino passport. I can't get a U.S. passport. And I'm not going to get it for 4 other weeks. And so they gave me like this certificate with my photo in it, like notarized, basically saying that the Philippine government know that I'm here. And I swear to God, I think the consulate was like on the phone just waiting for me to call if anything had happened or it was questioned. Thankfully, it actually went through. Maybe it was 7 o'clock in the morning. Maybe they didn't care. But you know, it's like that and also driving. So I'm not driving. I've given up the privilege. I hope everybody here owns a driver's license. Please give it a big hug. you know, you forget just how much of a privilege it is to have a driver's license. Man, is there anything more American than driving?
Flying.
Like getting in a car and flying, and now it's like...
Well, here's a very American question. Given your position up till now, what's your take on Mark Zuckerberg's mission to change social norms of privacy?
Oh, Lord.
Good question.
I'm not going to speak for Mark Zuckerberg, but...
No, your opinion of
it. My opinion of it. It's radical. It's an incredibly radical thing. And I think the consequences we're just starting to feel. Let me tell you this right now. Like, there are a bunch of undocumented people that I've heard from, not even people in their 30s, who have started emailing me and just coming out to me about their status. And people, young undocumented people can tell you right now that they're coming out within their own social networks, posting it on their wall, and some friends wouldn't know it. And all of a sudden, you're watching the stream of wall posts thinking, how are they going to react, right? We are living in an incredible age in which we are literally testing everybody's empathy quotient. Everybody's empathy quotient, you know? And to me, that's so exciting. To be able to say, what makes you think that I'm not a human being like you? And post it, and people have an argument. Like, I have a cousin, my Ate Gladys, which means, like, she's an older cousin of mine. And she's gotten on some, like, fights on Facebook with people who have been like, deport him now. And my Ate Gladys is actually, she's actually a dentist. I'm sure she's busy. And yet she's, like, Facebooking away, arguing with this woman. But the fact that they're having that very public argument on Facebook, which is public, I think is a good thing. And the fact that I can actually say to my, I have like 3,800 friends on Facebook or whatever, that I'm undocumented. You know what? You do what you want to do with that. I'm going to get, like, kind of saying that I'm gay. Like, you do what you want to, because at the end of the day, it's not about me. It's actually really about you.
But you said, you've said that coming, I think when we had a conversation,
yeah,
coming out as gay was not nearly as dangerous as coming out as an illegal immigrant.
Thankfully, this country doesn't deport gay people. That's wonderful that, you know, we don't do that. Hopefully, we'll let them get married.
Hey, well, why haven't you been deported?
When I decided to do this, I knew that that was one of the first things I had to figure out was what kind of legal advice am I going to need? And again, I treated it like a news story. I must have talked to like 25 lawyers, many of whom said that this is legal suicide. Like, you shouldn't be doing this. But I'm ready and for kind of everything that could happen. And the government hasn't done anything yet. I mean, at the end of the day, I haven't killed anybody or gotten a DUI, or I haven't given them any reason. I'm not a high in the priority list in terms of somebody that they're going to target. But being public as I have, you know, this was a conscious decision on my part in basically saying, I'm just one story. Right.
Someone asked, why have you not gotten married to a U.S. citizen, which I think is something that your relatives wondered at one point.
Oh,
your grandfather thought, right?
So that was actually a big thing. Actually, there's somebody in this audience who offered to marry me. I'm not going to embarrass her right now. My dear Natalie's here. So I'm not going to mention her last name. So Natalie's here. And when in high school, I was like driving Miss Daisy. Like, everybody drove me around. And she was one of those people that drove me around, and our classmate Lilia is here too. So when I came out to them about this, actually some of them offered to marry me. And at that point, I was already openly gay. And my grandfather and I had a very big fight about this, because his plan was I should get married to an American citizen and be done with this. But I told him that I wasn't going to do that. I told him that I wasn't going to correct what I thought of back then as a mistake with another mistake. And I was going to, as crazy as it sounds, I was going to honestly live with this lie. I was going to try to. As for gay marriage, as you know, there's a thing called the Defense of Marriage Act. So even if I got married in New York, the federal government, which handles immigration, doesn't allow gay people, doesn't recognize that marriage. So basically, I'm kind of cornered.
Have you, but, you know, you've had relationships,
yeah,
throughout your adult life. Have you told everyone you've been in a relationship with? Did you tell everyone that you were in a relationship with?
The week before it came out, before the article got published, yes. Because some of them were wondering why I never took that trip to Colombia or to Mexico, or I don't like to go to Mexico. No, I don't want to go to Colombia. I mean, you know, isn't there drugs there or something? The lies, man, the lies. It's just like, you know, it's so silly. I remember I got offered to go to like an expense paid trip to Switzerland last year. And my friend Kelly Goff was trying to get me to go. And I had to tell her, you know, Filipinos are crazy about weddings, and my cousin's getting married, and I got to go to the wedding. That was the best excuse I can come up with.
To go back for a second to the question about why you're still here.
So
do you have, I mean, have you made representations? Do you have people who support you, who have talked to people in immigration? I mean, do you have inroads there that make you feel a little safer than maybe someone else might?
I didn't want to be, I mean, this was kind of a big debate within our team. I should say, by the way, I'm sorry, Jake, that I'm embarrassing you. Would you mind standing up? This is Jake Brewer. Jake, stand up, man. I'm sorry.
Stand up, Jake. It's radio.
Oh, yeah, it's radio. I'm sorry. You can't see him. So Jake is, like, one of my best friends. He actually just wrote a blog post called, like, My Illegal Brother to explain this kind of when I came out to him about this earlier this year. And he's one of the co-founders of Define American. Because when I decided to do this, I wanted to team myself up with the best people I could possibly come up with. And one of them is Jake. And this question of, like, how am I, from the legal perspective, it's been really hard. Because I mean, in many ways, I've been playing kind of offense, you know? Like, I don't know what the government is going to do.
Have you?
Yeah.
Gotten people to represent you?
In terms of, like, congressmen, you mean? Like,
yeah.
The people? That was a big debate that we were having, whether I should pursue something that would just protect me. A private bill of sorts, which gets offered once in a while. We tried to pursue it to some extent to get me some protection. And one of our co-founders, Alicia Menendez, said, you're no use to this thing if you get deported, Jose, so we need to get you protection. But at one point, I actually said to all of them in an email that I sent at like 3 a.m., I don't know if you remember this, Jake. Oh, yeah. I was like, well, I don't want to come out with this and all of a sudden just like it's going to look like I'm just out to save myself. That's not the point. The point was to make a statement and say that whatever situation I'm in, whatever who I am and whatever I've achieved, I'm still one of these 11 million undocumented people. And so we haven't fully pursued that, and I haven't asked a senator or a congressman for a private bill. Because at the end of the day, I am not an exception.
We are going to start taking questions.
Oh, yeah.
So if you'd like to line up behind the mics there, there's one there, there's one there. Please do so sooner rather than later. And in the meantime, how bad would it be for you to go back to the Philippines?
How bad would it be?
I'm not sure.
I mean, I haven't seen my mother 18 years on August 3rd. So I'd love to see her. There's a lot of damage there that I need to take care of in terms of like the fact that I've not ignored her, but it was just been so, I don't know if many of you have read the essay, but the most painful part has been writing about her. So it wouldn't be, I don't think it'd be bad at all. I just want to be able to come back to America. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
First of all, I just want to say thank you for sharing your story. It means a lot to me. I wanted to know how living in a compartmentalized way has affected your thinking and your memories.
Wow. It's so funny what happens when you tell a lie to yourself, you know? It's like, it almost just kind of takes a corner in your head. Because there are times when I forget that I'm in this situation, you know? And then, of course, reality comes knocking back and like, oh, you can't do that. Like, you know, when Phil was trying to get me that job, I was actually thinking, that sounds like a good job, Phil. Maybe I'll go take you up on that. And then I'm realizing that, oh, I think I'm going to go come out with this, and I didn't want to put you in trouble. So there's that.
Too late.
I think it is really, like, I don't really know. It's almost as if I'm just getting to know myself in a way, coming out with this like this, you know? And I can only imagine what other undocumented people, especially the students, think through. It's hard enough to get through high school. We all know that. Can you imagine having to go through high school with this in your head? I'm surprised, frankly, that I didn't just end up doing drugs or getting somebody, I guess I couldn't have gotten anybody pregnant. but you know what I'm saying? It's like, I'm surprised that I didn't just decided that I was gonna give up. Because I guess Pat, and Rich and Jim and everybody just encouraged me so much. But back to the memories question, I think it's really affected the way that I think about my worth and who I am, you know. And I hope to get to a better place at that.
Hi. Obviously, this is a debate that's been going on for quite some time. And I read your article. You know, I grew up in Cupertino, went to Monta Vista. So immediately, like, I was like, oh, I know who some of these people are. And so your story kind of spoke to me as, like, I can understand this upbringing that you were in. So what I'd like to know is, what do you define as an undocumented immigrant who deserves a path towards, you know, towards a green card or towards being able to stay here? What is it that you see that makes that? Because obviously this is something you need, you know, that we need to have people understand and want to get behind.
I mean, I think, you know, this country, and actually I was just on a round table with George Will, of all people, conservative, and he and I actually agreed. I mean, he had a great statement in the program when he said, every advanced degree in this country which should come with a green card. We are now at a moment, this is George Will, who said this on camera, that advanced degrees should come with a green card. But not everybody has an advanced degree. So what are we supposed to do with the day laborer who's just trying to make ends meet? And who do you think a lot of these undocumented students come home to when they come from school? Right?
Right.
Thank you. I'm so glad that you understand that. In many ways, the DREAM Act has been the biggest rallying cry because it's the most sympathetic. It's the one that can make most sense, and which is great. But again, I don't think we're asking the harder questions, which is that, who are they going home to? And why are they here? Why do their parents, under whatever odds, may it be crossing the border, my God, some of these stories, you know? By the way, I come from what they call a mixed status family. Both of my grandparents are documented. They're American citizens, right? And to your question, and a lot of conservatives have said this, including George Will, we are not going to deport 11 million people in this country. So are we all just going to let them work in a shadow economy and let them live as kind of these underground lives? What if we did? What if we actually gave them a path? I can't believe I recently finished reading President Bush's memoir, Decision Points. Chapter 9 was on leadership. It's a great chapter. And the chapter ended, 20 pages, was on immigration reform. And George Bush, if you recall, was the first president to give a prime time speech on immigration reform, 19 minutes, in which he said, we are a nation of immigrants and we're a country of laws. How do we find a middle ground? And 5 years later, we're still not there. And I think, back to your question, at the end of the day, as one of those 11 million people, I'd be more than happy to get in some sort of line, some sort of path. But don't tell, you know, as somebody who had been, I think, contributing to this country, as somebody who had been paying taxes and paying Social Security, I just want to be in whatever that line is. And I think we have to think about this issue a lot more holistically than the way we're thinking about it now. And this is among even liberals and progressives.
Yes, sir.
Jose, this is a follow-up to Phil's question. Has the USCIS ever contacted you since your article came out? If not, what do you think is the message that is being sent to the other undocumented individuals in this country?
That's a great question.
Like, a lot of people in the Bay Area know about the Cuevas family.
Yeah.
And I'm sure you know about that story.
Yes,
they were actually deported, and they had the same story. They were brought here when they were practically infants, and they didn't know they were undocumented until the deportation papers came. And despite all the community efforts to save them from deportation, they had to be sent back to the Philippines. So do you think this gives sort of the perception of a double standard?
Well, what's interesting there too, sir, is, you know, a few weeks ago, John Morton of ICE issued a memo, right, basically granting prosecutorial discretion. Sorry, I'm mangling that. basically saying that it's not necessarily a blanket statement as to how to handle all undocumented people, but clearly they're trying to send a message that not everyone, you know, they're going to pick and choose what happens here. And not all immigration cases are alike. Like, my circumstances are completely different from a lot of other people's circumstances. Is there a double standard? You bet there is. I mean, I don't need to tell you that. There's a group called dreamactivists.org. Check that out as well. And they email a lot of kids, you know, a lot of undocumented people who are getting deported, who are in deportation proceedings, right, as we speak. I actually met a Filipino woman yesterday on the street who recognized me. And she said that she was on deportation proceedings and how I could help her out. So I can, you know, at the end of the day, on Define America, you know, this is what DefineAmerican.com is going to be about. You know, there's a big discussion about this issue already, and we're just trying to add value to that conversation and to tell other stories. And so that at the end of the day, there isn't going to be such a double standard. That's not going to be under our control. But it's sad that that's happening under the Obama administration.
How are you living these days?
How am I living? With a lot of goodwill. So DefineAmerican.com is this thing that we started when the article was launched. And thankfully, we're a project of the Tides Foundation here in San Francisco. So please check it out. There's been some people who actually have donated in the beginning to actually let us do this work. We've only been at this we started the organization early April. And we've spent about $60,000. And the work that we've been able to do with that money has been really kind of incredible. And thankfully, there are donors that have given money to this organization that's helping actually, you know, provide for whatever it is that I need expenses-wise. But they can't pay me. Nobody can pay me, which is hard. But I'm trying to figure out a way. I actually have one lawyer, one of my pro bono lawyers. I have seven lawyers from the Filipino American Legal Defense Fund. And one of them is trying to figure out a way to get me some sort of a way for money to come in a legal way so that IRS can't go after me.
Taxes. Yes, sir.
Taxes. Yes, sir.
Thank you very much for coming here. I want to personally thank you because we share similar stories. My status was revealed last year for being a student body president leader at Fresno State. And so hearing you say that and what you've been facing, it's my exact same situation. And I guess my question to you is, when students come and ask you for advice, and a lot of them do, they still come to me from across the United States, and also students that are taking action and they're actually releasing their statuses themselves, what advice would you give them? Because I don't give them legal advice. My lawyers also tell me, don't tell them to come out. Because it might be dangerous. You know, they're not as lucky as you are. That might be protected by the media, so to speak. But it's also hard to not let them do something, be passionate, and advocate for the DREAM Act and other bills.
What have you been telling them?
I've been telling them that personally I would not do it, but I understand your passion and your concerns. Just be careful and...
Of course, be
just
careful.
Let me know what happens.
But you know, I'm sorry, what is your name again?
Pedro Ramirez.
Pedro. If we don't speak up for ourselves, who else is going to do it?
Yeah, that's exactly what I say.
It's, you know, and it's like,
choice.
It's gotten to this point where it's like, which is why for me, it's been really interesting reading about the civil rights movement, you know, and kind of a lot of the activism that went on there and the marriage. I'm a big James Baldwin fan. I don't know if anybody here knows James Baldwin. Thank you. And Baldwin was really game-changing, you know, in the 50s and 60s because he was able to look at white America and says, this is a marriage, you and I. We have to figure this out. And I've been kind of taking that as a guidance and saying, you know, look, illegal immigration is not just about me, it's about you too. You have to look at yourself and ask yourself, what role do you play in this? And I do believe that this is one of the civil rights causes of your generation, of our generation, although I'm a lot older than you probably. So all we can really do is speak up and organize, you know? One voice is never enough. It's never enough.
You're 30. You don't get to have, say old and
oh,
same.
I'm sorry.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, as a fellow...
Mandeep, yes. Hi, how are you?
I'm good. As a fellow undocumented immigrant, I just want to say, like, I respect you so much for coming out on the scale that you did. Like, that's amazing. The media, I feel like, loves to pick up on stories of exceptional, you know, undocumented students and undocumented people. I came out a couple weeks ago, and it you know, became this whole thing. But what...
She is a pre-med student at UC Davis. She wants to help save lives, and we're not going to let her work. But go ahead. I'm sorry. Please, go ahead.
What do you say to... I've been approached by this group called 67 Sueños, which is amazing. You guys should check it out. But they help students who are kind of stuck in the middle, who aren't, you know, honor roll 4.0 kids, who have to work in the fields over the summer, who can't always afford, you know, things that will help them out academically. What do you say to those kids that the media is not going to, you know, love and want to put in front of the camera? Like, what?
I'm so glad you asked that question. And I'm sure you're asking yourself the same question, aren't you?
Yeah.
Like, at the end of the day, not everybody, and this is a point that I really want to be very unequivocally clear about. Undocumented people are no different from you and I. We just want the same things that you do. We want to be lawyers, we want to be doctors, but at the end of the day, we also just, you know, we just, maybe we're happy with just having that 9-to-5 job and going home and taking care of our kids. And so really what we're talking about here is the dignity, right? And it's been tough because, again, it's been easier, it's been more palatable or easy to stomach when you're talking about the pre-med student or like the guy who happened to have been a part of a team that won a Pulitzer. That's easier to digest. But what do you do about the kids who aren't in that situation? Well, my answer to that is, which is why I'm telling you, Mrs. Denny, who was my choir teacher, she was the first person I ever told that I was undocumented because she wanted the choir to go to Japan, and I told her I couldn't go. And then she changed the thing. She said, we're going to go to Hawaii instead. 3 months ago was actually the first time that she and I spoke about this. And I said, why did you change your mind? And she said, because I wasn't going to leave any of my students behind. It wasn't because I was a good singer. I was actually pretty bad. I was, thanks. I wasn't that good of a performer or a good singer. It was just because she wasn't going to leave any of the students behind. She wasn't going to leave any of the students behind. God, can you imagine what would happen if we actually thought that way? You know, but it's going to be tough. I mean, it's tougher enough. I mean, we can have a civil discussion about the DREAM Act here, but how does it play in Des Moines, Iowa? How does it play in Kentucky? I don't know. We're going to figure it out. I'm going to go there this fall. It's going to be fun.
Okay, we have a tradition, and I have it here. Oh, there we go.
Yeah.
Newly founded. Informed tradition.
Okay.
That we ask of all our speakers the following question. It's a big softball. What's your 60-second idea to change the world?
Besides going to defineamerican.com, to really be able to talk to people who don't agree with you and who don't think the way that you do. To get outside of your comfort zone and get out of your circle and challenge people as to why they think what they think. Because if all we do is talk to each other, we're not going to get anywhere. And that's why we're about conversation, because that's where everything starts. Right? So that's my idea for that. So thank you so much for coming.
Our thanks to Jose Antonio Vargas for sharing his thoughts with us tonight. I'm Phil Bronstein, and now this meeting of the Commonwealth Club and its Inform Division is adjourned. Thank you all.
Amen. That was good.